Fears into
the wind. I am desperate for a touch of heaven. Whoa.
Eisenbauer heads. There, my Father, just thank you for another day, Lord, just to worship you, Lord, and just to be here in your presence, Lord, to follow other fellow Christians, Lord, and our brothers and sisters. I just pray for the message tonight, Lord, that it'll just be spoken through your word, Lord, and that the Holy Spirit would just envelop us, Lord, just so we can just hear what you need to tell us, Lord, for the week, for the months, for our years. I just pray that you'll continue being with us through this week, Lord, through this time of just giving, Lord. Christmas is coming up, Lord, and I just pray that we'll just hold it all in, Lord, while there's just so much pain and suffering, Lord, and that we can just look to you for our hope, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for those who are here, and thank you for those who are able to stream in with us on this Wednesday. Before we start, a little announcements pertaining to this church. For this Christmas celebration, if you would like to share your Christmas wish, New Year wish with the church for us to put in our streaming service, feel free to record yourself about 5 to 10 seconds and send that to myself or pastor, and then I will then upload that and make a little video collage on for our Christmas celebration and also our New Year celebration. So if you're interested, please do so. So let's go in a word of prayer. Dear Father God, thank you so much for today. Father, thank you for an opportunity again to come into your house, Father, to share in your celebration, a celebration that is dear to your heart. And that's what we're going to talk about today is the celebration that you're wanting us to be a part of and to find out what things can hinder that celebration in your house, Father. Father, be with me and be with Kendall as we bring your word, Father. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, in talk about celebration, I want to share with you a story. There was this couple, a 70-year-old couple that enjoyed 50 years of an awesome marriage. They had 7 kids. So their kids and friends wanted to give them a party. So they invited the friends, had a big band, a big feast. The party was going to be one of the best. And there was going to be a big celebration because they want to renew their vows. But there was one problem. Of the 7 kids that was supposed to show up, one didn't show up. The daughter, a long time ago, had this falling out with one of her sisters. And it wasn't that, you know, she had problems with her parents. It was the fact that she couldn't get along with her sister. Some argument in the past kept her from coming to this party. Although this party was a good party, the celebration was excellent, but this celebration could have been more, could have been better if the daughter would have joined in the rest of the family. Now, it really amazes me that one person can have such a detrimental effect, either positive or bad. Now, as for me, you know, I'm honored. I'm very honored to be a part of this church. I'm honored to be involved in a ministry that God has put in my heart, both on Sunday streaming and then also on Wednesday streaming, to be working alongside in conjunction with the leadership here at this church, along with my peers, Brother Lennon, Brother Green, and Sister May, and the youth that allow liberty, and also to work in conjunction with my friends here from Amen Baptist Church. And we have come a long ways. We have come a long ways in this mutual respect and this bonding, this love and this bond that we have developed that I pray never will be broken as we are serving the Lord together. That's why I want to talk about this subject today. Now, in the midst of all of this streaming, this praise and worship band, all of this that we're doing on both on Wednesdays and Sundays, if we lose sight of what really matters, if we lose sight of the bigger picture, if we lose sight of God, and that we're doing this for Him, not for us, not individually, it's all for Him. If we lose sight of that, we'll be no better than that sister that didn't join in the celebration. We, likewise, will hinder the celebration in God's church if we lose sight of what's more important in all of this that we're doing. So, let me ask, what would you say brings the most joy and celebration to God the Father? Is it this that we do every Wednesday and Sunday? I don't think so, if you think about it. I think what brings more joy and celebration to God the Father is when His words touches the lives of somebody who does not know Him that will come and accept Him as Lord and Savior. That brings Him joy and celebration. And also what will bring Him celebration is when His children that for some reason is lost and backslide has now decided to come back and repent. I think that's what gives Him celebration in His house. So as we are doing all this together, we have to be careful not to lose sight of what is more important. Why we're here doing what we do, week in, week out. We could be doing other things, more fun than this, but we decide to do this because we see something that's more important, and that's the celebration of God, His happiness, and why He wants to celebrate. So what can hinder this celebration? What can harm God's happiness in this celebration? Well, that's what we're going to learn today. And we're going to learn this in the story of the prodigal son's big brother. You know, we harped on the prodigal son, but I want to focus on his big brother. And I want to focus on the attitude that if we're not careful, will hinder and harm the celebration in God's house. So most of us are familiar with the story of the prodigal son, right? It's about a man who goes to his father and requests the inheritance early. So the father gives it to him, and then he runs away to this fall-off land, and he spends his money wildly on this and that. So at the time when his money ran out, a famine hit the land. So now he's broke, cold, and hungry. So he goes and gets a job feeding somebody's pig or something. And then one day he realized that he was wanting to eat the food that the pig was given. And then at that low part of his life, he realized, you know what? My father's servant eats better than this. Well, I'm going to go back to my father, beg him to take me back, not as a son, but a servant. So he decides to go, and then on his way close to his house, his father sees him. His father runs out there in joy, hugs him, kisses him, and the father tells his servant, hey, go get me a ring, get some sandals, put it on my son's finger and his feet. We're going to celebrate. We're going to have a big feast. My son was lost, now he's found. That is the same analogy of what our Heavenly Father is like when His lost children comes back home. He's very happy, and that's what He wants to celebrate in His house. Now, this was a great day for the father. He had longed so long for his son to return ever since he left that house a long time ago. The house was full of celebration, potential. The band was there, food was there, the servant was ready, the father was ready. But there was one problem. The oldest brother was nowhere to be found. So if you have your Bible, please turn with me to Luke chapters 15, verses 25 to 32. My son here, Kendall, he's going to read this for us, okay? Just take off your mask. Okay, just read that.
Now his older son was in the field. As he came near the house, he heard music and dancing, so he summoned one of the servants, questioning what these things meant. "Your brother is here," he told him, "and your father has slaughtered the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and didn't want to go in, so his father came out and plead with him. But he replied to his father, "Look, I have been slaving many years for you. I have never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me a goat so that I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your assets with prostitutes, you slaughtered the fattened calf for him." "Son," he said to him, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found."
Thank you, buddy. That's good. Good job. Now, the oldest brother was outside. He was grumbling, complaining, and refused to go in to celebrate with the father and his little brother and the other party guests. So the father had to leave that party, come out, and deal with this rebellious son of his. Now, this man's actions, his attitude, illustrates a problem that most of us at church have. And if we're not careful, this attitude will hinder the celebration and the joy in the Father's house. Now, although this could be a very good celebration, it could have been much better. And there's a great celebration here at Lao Liberty and your church respectively. A great celebration of God, what God wants us to do in our respective churches is to take His word to the people who may not know who He is or who have heard Him before but have since backslid, and they're ready to come back to the Father. Could you imagine what a celebration that would be in the Father's house? But if we're not careful and learn from this passage, our Heavenly Father's party will not be what it can be. So let's walk through the scripture that Kendall just read, and let's find out some attitudes and some actions that will hinder the Father's celebration in this house. Now, the first thing that what we just read that I want to highlight was the distance of the brother can hinder the celebration. Now, think about what Kendall just read. When the party started, the oldest son was out in the field. He hears music, he comes close to the house, and then he calls his servants and asks, "Hey, what's going on?" So the servant told him, "Hey, you know, your brother is lost, or was lost, now he's found. Your father is so happy he's going to have a big party because your brother is safe and sound." Now, this older brother was right outside the door of the father's house. Although he was right outside, he could have been a million of miles away in terms of his attitude. Now, I could see the father looking out the window, waiting for the big brother to show up. You know, he's depending on his big brother to come and jump in the celebration. You know, although the father was inside the party with guests, with this son who's lost, he's still looking out the window, waiting for the big brother to come in and celebrate this special moment. Because, you know, us parents, and my mom and my dad does the same thing, there's something about having the whole family in one house. My mom would volunteer to cook just to have everybody come and eat in her house on one table, at one table, under one roof. That's special for her. And if one is sick or if one is far away, that celebration is not quite the same. Our Heavenly Father is the same. What he wants is all of us to have fellowship together in one house, in one, on one table, his table. Now, you know, when I say the distance of the brother or sister hinders the celebration in the father's house, I'm not talking about some people who are physically not coming to church. That's not the case sometimes. Sometimes the distance that I'm talking about, spiritual distance, and or worse, emotional distance. People can be sitting next to each other at church, but they could be miles away in terms of their spiritual connection. The oldest brother was right outside the door. He was complaining about everything that he didn't get. And we have some brothers and sisters at church will be coming to church week in, week out, complaining, not helping, not encouraging, not contributing, not participating, not supporting when the prodigal brother and sisters has changed their life with the word of God. They don't contribute. And as a result, they're distancing themselves both physically, emotionally, and worse, spiritually. And that distance will hinder the party, the celebration at the Father's house. And from what we just read, what causes this distance in this brother's heart? In this particular case, he was angry, right? You look at verse 28. Verse 28 says, and it plainly states that the oldest brother was angry. Now, instead of getting over his anger, he allowed his anger to overtake him. Now, this man should have been overjoyed because his brother came back. And he should have been overjoyed if his heart is right, that his father, whose heart is breaking day in, day out when the little brother left, now the father is so happy. He should have been inside the house happy, glad that his little brother's back. But instead, he let that deep hate, anger inside his heart cause him to whine, complain. And sometimes, you know, if you think about in church, some churches, instead of rejoicing of what God is doing in other people's lives, and instead of it rejoicing on how God changes people, some of our brothers and sisters complain. They whine, they gripe, they get angry. For example, if money aren't spent the way they want, they get angry. If decisions are made at church that they do not agree with, they get angry. If nobody calls them because they're sick, they get angry. So they get angry. And anger builds and builds. It boils, right? And it begins to cause that person to act very irrationally. Angry people tend to have a negative outlook on certain things. And their impact, that negative impact, will result in a negative impact in the church. And they'll spread discord, disagreement, division amongst the church. And this negativity will spread like fire, wildfire. And when this happens, it diverts. It takes away the attention. It takes away the focus from God to this nonsense of anger. And it blinds people on in what God is doing to people's lives. As a result, anger of the big brother hindered the celebration of the Father's house. So what happens when anger creeps into your heart? There's a tendency for grown people, grown men and women, to act like little kids, little children. Consider the third point, that the childishness of the brother or sister will hinder the celebration in the father's house. Now, verse 28 says that the older brother would not go in. So the father had to come out and plead with him, right? Now, this is a grown man. His father had to come out and say, Bakla, oi, ila, oi. Whenever you hear Bakla, oi, or ila, oi, and that's translated in from Laos to English as my dear, or, you know, in my household, is either they want something for me to do, or I'm pretty much acting bad, and they're trying to come down to my little childish level. Whenever I hear ila, bakla, that's typically what happens in my household. And that's what happened here. He wouldn't go in, so his father had to come out of the party and plead with him to try to come back in. Now, I've said that this guy is the older elder brother, but you wouldn't have known that by his actions. In fact, he's conducting himself like a little kid, like a little child. Outside, refused to go in, wah, wah, because I didn't get my way. Now, what should have been a wonderful day for the father is hampered by the selfish response of that older brother. So obviously, this childishness will hinder the party, the celebration in the father's house. The same thing happens in churches nowadays, is that, you know, although there's childish people, God still loves, God still saves. But this childishness of our brothers and sisters, if we're not careful, will have an effect in the father's house. The immaturity will cause other people to leave the church. Likewise, they will hinder others from coming to church. Childish folks tends to cause other people to act childish as well. It's contagious sometimes. Also, their childish ways will prevent that true spirit of worship, that true focus to God the Father. So people will see their actions, and non-believers will say, I don't want nothing to do with that Christian if that's the way he acts. And that hurts our faith. You know, I've read and I've heard stories of church splitting over some minute argument. Little things cause fights in the church. People get thrown out of church. People don't come to church. Guys, my friends, this childishness will make our Father in heaven not happy. And if we are Christians, if we are to be Christ-like, we have to be the older brother in every situation. We have to be the better man or woman of these situations. And just like the father did in this story, he had to leave the party to come and deal with this problem. And sometimes God will deal with the problem one way or another if he must. So far, we have talked about what? The distance of a brother, spiritual distance, the anger of this brother, and the childishness of this brother. All of these are problems that is an outward expression of something more sinister on the inside. It's an expression of an inside problem. What's the root of the anger? What's the root of the distance? What's the root of the childishness, if I had to ask? It's pride. Consider the fourth point. The pride of the big brother hindered that party at the father's house. Verse 29 says that this is the brother saying to the father, he says, look, I have been slaving many years for you and I have never disobeyed your order. Now, if you were in a room with three people If one person says, look, Dad, I never disobeyed you, what does that tell you about the other guy? If I never disobeyed you, hint, hint, this guy have, right? So this man's pride is very apparent. He's saying, hey, all these years, Dad, I have worked for you, I have obeyed you, I never disobeyed your command. I did everything you asked me to. This guy, what about this guy? I could guarantee you that when there's disagreement, dissatisfaction in a church, pride is typically the root of all the problem. People start comparing themselves to other people. They lift them up and they push others down. And they focus not on the Savior, but they focus on themselves. And somewhere along the line, everything is about them, their wants, their needs. Let me remind you that God's words in the Bible that Kendall's going to read highlights selfish pride. Proverbs 16:18 says this.
Pride comes before destruction and an arrogant spirit before a fall.
And Philippians 2:3-4.
Do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility consider others as more important than yourselves. Everyone should look not to his own interests, but rather to the interests of others.
Very good, buddy. Thank you. The older brother, if you think about it, didn't care whether the little brother was there or not. The older brother didn't care much about the father's happiness. He didn't care neither about the father's glory in this party. What he cared about was his glory, how good he was, how obedient he was, how great he is by obeying the father. He was more worried about his glory than the father. Sadly, sometimes selfish brothers and sisters at church, when they come to church, when they seek their own glory, when they seek their own needs and wants, that hinders the celebration in the Father's house. They seek to attain glory for themselves and not to glorify what's more important, which is the Father. It's not really hard to figure out what they are all about. All you have to do is listen to what they say, because Matthew 12:34 says, for the mouth speaks from the overflow of the heart, meaning what you speak is what your heart is overflowing from, or what things are coming from. If pride is in their heart, it will be apparent in what they say and what they do. And their pride would no doubt hinder the party, the celebration in the Father's house. So as we move on, another thing that we see from this story of this older brother is that the jealousy of the older brother will hinder that party. Verse 29 and 30, if you look at it closely, the brother says, yet you never gave me a goat so that I can celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your assets with prostitutes, you slaughter a fattened calf for him. Now, these verses illustrate a major problem with this guy. He was jealous of his little brother. Not only was he jealous of this big party that his father threw for him, he was jealous of the things that the brother did when the brother was way off in that land. Why would I say that? Think about why would I say that? Remember, this older brother haven't talked to the brother yet, has he? He's out in the field. So he hears this party, he comes by, he hadn't even talked to the father about anything. So how did he know that this little brother wastes his money on this, that, and the other? Where did he get this idea from? I say this again. Matthew 12:34. For the mouth speaks from the overflow of the heart. This guy is accusing his brother of doing things that he wants to do, but didn't get a chance to do. He's jealous. My friends, if we spend our time looking at others instead of Jesus, when we're more focused on their abilities, when we're more focused on their opportunities, we're constantly looking at what they have. And when you compare it to what you have, and if you don't have what they have because you're looking at them too much and not focus on God, you become jealous. That jealousy tight squeezes your heart. Bitterness comes into play, will consume you, and jealousy will no doubt hinder the celebration in the Father's house. So distance, anger, childishness, pride, jealousy will always hinder the celebration of the Father's house. And lastly, and more important, if we think about the main point of this message, is the unthankfulness of a brother or sister will hinder that celebration in the Father's house. Look at verse 31 to 32. So here's the father responding to all of this nonsense. He says, "Son," he said to him, "you are always with me, and everything that I have is yours." And I like that verse. Let's just stop and talk about that. So the father is saying, "Hey, you know, son, all I have, all of this is yours. You have food, you have warmth. All of this is yours. I'm with you, you and me, I'm with you, we're together." But the father said, "But we have to celebrate and rejoice because your brother, this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So the father listens to the son's complaint, but then he informed him that all of this is yours. Same way with us as Christians. We brag about Jesus is in my heart. I'm walking with God. I have God in my heart. That's the point. He is with you. You are with him. Everything that he has is yours. All the blessings, all the joy, all the happiness is yours. But your brother, your sister was lost. They didn't have this. Now they're found. We have to celebrate that together. The older brother lost sight of what mattered to the father. We as Christians who claim to have Jesus in our hearts, who is currently walking with him, we are that big brother. We're the older brother, and we have to be careful not to lose sight of that relationship with the Father. This brother did. Instead of being grateful of what he had, he was more focused on what he did not have. Instead of looking at the blessings, the joy, the wealth, the privilege of being with the Father, he focused more on his anger, his jealousy, his childishness. He acted in unthankful manner. Unthankfulness is found in people who don't appreciate the things that God has given them, what God has blessed them with. They look at negatively on things when things don't go their way. They forget what God has given them, and as a result, they gripe, they complain. These things, distance, anger, childishness, pride, jealousy, and unthankfulness will always hinder the celebration in the Father's house. Now, in closing, we're the big brother in this story. We should be blessed by having God in our hearts. We pray to him. We walk with him. Every day, each and every day, we should be happy. What we're doing in this ministry, in your ministry out there, is to help celebrate in the Father's house when our little brother, little sister has come back home to our Father, our Heavenly Father, so that he can be happy. He can celebrate with his lost son and the son that's always on his next to him. That's us. That's why we do what we do. For him, not for us. And we should not do anything that will hinder that celebration in the Father's house. Now, you may be hearing this or viewing this today, and you're that prodigal little brother and little sister who left the Father's house spiritually. And you're wasting all your blessings on wild living. Before long, you'll find yourself in that little pig pen. Maybe you're realizing that now as you're hearing me speak. Why don't you do what the prodigal son did and come home? Come home to the Father. And I could assure you that our Father, our Heavenly Father, will accept you, will raise you up above his servants and put a ring in your finger and kill a fat cow and have a celebration. Or maybe you're hearing this and you don't know about this Father of mine in heaven. But I can guarantee you, if you will accept him as your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, he will adopt you into his family. And they will be a celebration in the Father's house. Or you might be viewing this and you realize that you are that big brother who, for whatever reason, have allowed your actions in terms of distance, your anger, your pride, your selfishness, your jealousy, and your unthankfulness have caused you to lose sight of your relationship with God the Father. Will you please repent in your heart today and come on in to this party? Don't sit outside. Don't stand outside. Come on in. Because the Father is longing for you to join your brother and your sister on that table. And he will have a big party. And he'll be so happy that we're all together again. And if you're in Fort Smith, Van Buren, the River Valley, if you don't have a church family and you would like to be with a church family, we welcome you to visit ours here at Loud Liberty. Please let us know in the comment section or on our church phone number on the streaming, and somebody will reach out to you. And with that said, I want to thank you for tuning in and taking your time to listen to this message. Because at the end of the day, we're here to glorify God the Father and not us individually. So with that, thank you. Let me close in a word of prayer. Dear Father God, thank you so much, Father, for allow me, Father, to share this message with your people. Father, I pray that this message will bring back the prodigal brother and sister out there. And I pray that they will come back to this house. Father God, I pray that your words will change people's lives. And they will yearn more of you. And they will accept you as their Lord and Savior. And they will be welcome into our family. And I pray that this message will humble and will soften the hearts of the older brothers and sisters who is hindering the party in your house, Father. Father, be with the youth be with the church here at La Liberty, along with countless churches out there in this area. Father, thank you, Father, for giving us this opportunity to be a part of this ministry. Father, we love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, buddy.
แบกการแค้นของข้าตาม